Clarification of the objective. Why are we sitting here? And I think the objective should come from the Rig Veda itself. Shall we just sort of quote the verse?
Yeah. Yes.
So this is the verse. So this book, Ardo, it's about rapture. It is about tapasya. It is about tapa. But we will begin by quoting a verse from the Rig Veda, from the 10th mandala, 88 sukta. So the Rig Veda is thousands of years old. It has about 1,000 hymns. These hymns are classified into 10 chapters known as mandalas. So I am going to just read one verse from the 10th mandala, which is at the beginning of the book. How many fires are there? How many suns? How many dawns? How many waters? I say this, O you fathers, not as a challenge. I ask it to know, O you poets.
Yeah, you see from these words what it's all about. It's about knowledge. But in order to start, I refer to another verse in the first mandala of the Rig Veda, the hymn 164, where you open the book and you read that there are two birds perched on the same tree, on opposite branches, to a couple of friends. And one of these birds eats the sweet berry of the peepal, and the other bird doesn't eat anything and just watches the other bird. You find these two verses without any sort of commentary in the Rig Veda. And then the story starts. You start to go through the other texts of the Veda. You through the Yajur Veda, the Brahmanas, the Upanishads, and suddenly you see the same image reappear and you start to understand what it is. Well, the first bird, the bird who is eating the berry, is all of us in every single moment. The only fact of perceiving the world is a way of eating it. We filter something and we appropriate something of a substance which is outside us. So we have one bird, the bird who is eating. And the other one will never eat. The other one watches. So you see how even the other bird is in us. Because whatever we do, there is someone who acts and someone who looks at the one who acts. We are two forever. We were never one. We were never an I. I is what is called an ahamkara, a fabrication of the I. And it is an illusion that there is only that subject. There are at least two subjects. And one will be called aham, I, and the other one, atman. That's to say self. Atman is simply a pronoun, a reflexive pronoun. And of these two, we are made, whatever we do, whether we realize it or not. For some people, the two birds will never be two separate beings. They will not realize that they are two. They will think they are only one. But for other ones, there will be a moment of detachment when they will discover that they are two. And that will be a real discovery. That is a radical discovery of the Vedas, and something which in other moments of history, in other places, was not really perceived. And that is why today I think it would be very useful for every one of us to refer back to these words and to these images.
Thank you. You see, the whole idea of seeing in a relationship, two people in a relationship, one speaking, the other listening, this concept recurs in the Indic traditions. Two birds on a tree in the Rig Veda. Later you have in the Bhagavad Gita the same idea again.
Exactly.
And again.
Yeah.
And again.
Well, Krishna and Arjuna are the two birds. It's as simple as that. Arjuna is the one who eats and who suffers, because when you eat, you kill someone. And Arjuna has a problem of whether to kill or not to kill some people who are his relatives. And Krishna is the self, and they are in touch, and they are talking. And that is something, you cannot go beyond that. You stop at that. And what you make of that is thought, simply.
I think with the Vedas, you find a new world. You know, Roberto uses this word, the Parthenon of words. When you go into the past, you see a whole remote people who are interested not in creation of buildings and empires, but through the act of ritual, and through the act of chanting, and through the act of gestures, you start moving allegedly outside, but also inside. And you discover birds, not just outside, but also inside. The act of observation, which is not just outside, but also inside. And therefore, space is not just outside, but also inside. And movement is not just outside, but also inside. And therefore, when you eat, the act of consumption, of devouring, is not just outside, but inside. And the aham thinks I am eating. The aham thinks that I am doing. And the atma watches very quietly and witnesses the act of devouring, of eating, of killing, of participating. Here we are all together consuming JLF. We are the birds who are eating the fruit called JLF. And the Atma is watching us consuming the fruit. And when you think of birds, your eye turns upwards and you start looking at the sky. And the sky unites people from all over the world. We all look up there. We may fight over land and over boundaries, over property, but then you look up at the sky. And in your book, Roberto, you talk about how the sky somewhere, he seems to unite these people. What's so special about the sky and the stars and the sun and the moon and the constellations? They seem to be talking to us. What do they reveal?
Well, the sky, in a way, is the first history book. And many people, many tribes started to read what had happened, not in books, but in the sky. And there is a very strange phenomenon which in a way made me to write the book which follows Ardor. Ardor was published in 2010. And six years later, I published another book, which is the eighth of the same work, which is made out of parts, and of which Ardor is the seventh part. The eighth part is called The Celestial Hunter, and it talks mainly, it refers to something happening in the sky. There is a very strange phenomenon of which no anthropologist ever has managed to give an explanation. There is a segment of the sky which goes from Sirius to Aldebaran, and in the middle of it you have Orion. Well, what happens is that in the most different civilizations, very far away one from the other, without any possibility of relations, contacts, that part of the sky has been defined the place of the hunter. Orion in the Greek mythology is the great hunter, the celestial hunter. And in the Vedas, you know that the sort of primordial story, which happens at the very beginning, before the world of the gods is established, happens there. And you have Prajapati, who is wounded by the arrow of Rudra in the moment in which he's trying to make love with his daughter, Ushas, and when they transform themselves in antelopes. And then Ushas flies and Prajapati is wounded. And out of his wound, in a way, the world is born and has to be remade. The world means to put together again the members, the dispersed members of Prajapati. And so you see, it's very paradoxical. Two essential stories are put on the same part of the sky. They are a story of hunting, and you have two different solutions. In one, the hunter is Orion, and that is the Greek tradition. In the other one, in a way, the victim, the one who is wounded by the arrow, is Orion. And Sirius, in one case, is the dog which follows the hunter. In the other case, is the mysterious Rudra, who shoots the arrow. So the consequences of these stories, both in Greece and in India, are endless. Practically, the whole of the Shatapatha Brahmana, which is the greatest of all the Brahmanas, and it is about 2,300 pages of a huge density of thought, refer to this story. Because lots of chapters start saying, Prajapati was alone, he was thinking of doing this and that, and then there were the devas and the asuras and the gods. On the other side, you have Greece, where not a single Greek author ever wrote from beginning to end the story of Orion. We have to reconstruct it out of fragments, very tiny and often very contradictory fragments. But we feel that the story is essential, as Prajapati was essential for India. And you know, why in Greece was it so? Probably because the story was too important and too archaic for being told from beginning to end. Levi-Strauss, who was a very cautious man, as you all know, wrote once that the mythology of Orion, according to him, went back to the Upper Paleolithic. So it was very, very far back, much before the world of agriculture, the, in a way, the world of people staying in cities, it refers to that huge part of our history when we were hunters. And that would bring us very far. I had to write a book of almost 500 pages to develop this point. But you see how it all starts from a story which you can find even in South America, in Suriname. You have myths connected with this hunter in the sky. So that is the first book out of which they learned. It's the first memory.
So you see two birds, and from two birds we move towards the hunter and the hunted. And it's very exciting how in Greece, what is the hunter becomes the hunted in India, and what is hunted in India is the hunter. And you find these different ideas emerging from the same sky, that one sky which unites us. Suddenly the way you see and who is watching us and the shifts in idea appears. You see, the archer becomes exciting for me. Why? The archer is a recurring theme, something which keeps coming, and you keep seeing the archer again and again. For example, in the Valmiki Ramayana, you have two birds flying in the sky, and the poet watches, he's the witness, and he watches a hunter shoot one of the birds, and the other bird starts to cry. And the poet in the book, Ka, you mentioned about it, where the poet is so moved by this incident that he curses the hunter, and the curse comes in the form of poetry. And therefore you suddenly see the sky, the act of hunting, the birds, the archer, in different cultures associated with poetry and pain and language and words.
I have to add one thing in order not to give the impression that things are so opposite and simple. The hunter at the end is hunted himself, and he's killed by the goddess of hunting, Artemis. And he's killed not because Artemis wants to kill him, but because her twin, Apollo, who is jealous of Orion, tells Artemis to shoot an arrow to a very small point that they see in the waves of the sea. And Artemis doesn't know what is that point, but she is a perfect archer. So she shoots the arrow, and the arrow goes to the head of Orion and kills him. So you see, the story is immensely complicated. It has various layers, as the Prajapati stories. So it has taken hundreds of years to sort of develop all this. And why? Because it refers to not thousands of years, but hundreds of thousands of years in which man was going through this strange, very complicated and harrowing story in which he was the hunter. He became the mighty hunter after having been for a much longer period the hunter, because man is not at the beginning a hunter. At the beginning, he is the prey of the great predators. That is what the paleoanthropologists have at last established in these last 40 years. And that changes totally our perspective on our past. Man became what we suppose to be man, imitating their killers. That is a very important passage. And that is implied in all the stories we are mentioning.
You see, so hunter becomes the hunted, the prey becomes the predator, becomes the prey. And this cycle of, in a way, when you take it to the metaphorical world and you move to the realm of relationships, when there's a relationship, who is the predator, who is the prey, who is the hunter, who is the hunted, all relationships are strained with tension. And you find this in the conversation of Gargi and Yajnavalkya. And you find this, so I'd like to read this passage from the book, which talks about Gargi, a philosopher, a lady and a philosopher.
One always says that women in the don't have a particular role, an important role in these ancient texts. That is totally wrong. Gargi is a great theologian. She is a great master of tissues, of texting. And she challenges the great master, the greatest master of all, Yajnavalkya, on the same level. And Yajnavalkya talks with her as with a very great theologian. And you know that in the Upanishads, when there are these duels of words, which are called Brahmodya, at the end, the one who loses can have his head bursting in pieces. So Gargi is risking a lot, asking Yajnavalkya, and she's on the same level as him.
So let's witness this. Let's witness this conversation. Was any milder. On the contrary, Gargi announced straight away that she would speak like a warrior from the land of the Kashi or Videha, who comes forth holding two arrows, ready to shoot the adversary. But the formulation of a question had changed. This time it was Kantian. Gargi was first with what weft time. That which is called the past, present, and future was woven, Yajnavalkya answered, with the weft of space, Akash. But Gargi had her second and last question in reverse. What was weft? Is space woven? At this point, Gargi might have been expecting a blunt refusal to answer, as on her previous occasion, together with a threat of death. This didn't happen. Indeed, Yajnavalkya's answer was immediate and expansive. He said the weft of space was woven on the indestructible Akshara. And he embarked on a lofty, intense, poetic explanation about Akshara. So here we find a transformation of the question and a transformation of the answer. And Roberto, you were telling me yesterday about transformation.
Yeah, well, that is, I think, the main point. You know, if you ask yourself, why should we go back to these texts? Why should they be of such relevance to us? Well, the answer is very simple, because they are a way of knowledge, and they are a way of knowledge which is radically opposite what is the mainstream knowledge today. So even only for that, as a pure shock, they are terribly useful. Moreover, you can get further and further on that line. What is the opposition? Well, if you think of what you find in the Western textbooks of philosophy, they all say that modern philosophy starts with Descartes and with a single verb, cogito, where you have a subject which is the I, the first bird. And that fiction of the single subject is immensely useful and effective. On that basis, techniques and technology and power are built. And it went on, and it is going on every day, and it will go on for a long time, I think. That means that all knowledge is conceived as a sort of prosthesis. You have in your pockets all of the, an iPhone or something of that kind. That is a kind of one of thousands of examples of this knowledge. And it all starts with the arrow and the bow of which we were talking before. A prosthesis is not a modern invention. It is a fundamental passage in the life of the mind. This on one hand. And then you open the Upanishad and you see that at a certain moment in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, for instance, you read that you become what you think. There is a knowledge is a metamorphosis. It is something which transforms the Atman itself and puts it in relation with that most mysterious word, which is a Brahman. Nobody knows what the Brahman is, and that's why Yajnavalkya was so cautious in responding to Gargi. But that is the essential point, because that is related to the Akshara, to something indestructible. And that, if you go some steps further, you will find the other totally, the other sort of peculiarity, irreducible peculiarity of Vedic thought. And that is having put consciousness at the beginning of everything, which is the opposite of what happened in the West, where, you know, it's very strange, but in these last 40 years, all of a sudden, science has discovered that they know a lot about physics, about microphysics, but they knew practically nothing about something which is as common as microphysics. That's consciousness. All of us partake of that. And from that moment, hundreds of books with the name, with the consciousness in the title have appeared. And the result, I'm quoting here a very illustrious philosopher from California, Searle, who said, well, we have to realize that in 40 years we have done practically nothing. We are at the beginning. We haven't managed to establish anything really important on this point. That's why consciousness is called today by the scientists, not by the common people, the hard problem. Stoppard wrote even a play with this title, The Hard Problem. The hardest of all. And you have legions of neuroscientists with funds of billions of dollars working on this subject and achieving practically nothing. On the other side, if some of these neuroscientists simply opened the Chandogya Upanishad or the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, they would have a shock. They would see how these people, very far away in time, started with consciousness. They thought that mind comes before matter, and it's enough to read one page of these texts to see how essential the fact of being conscious was for all of them. And that's probably one of the reasons why they developed this huge literature, which is neglected by everybody, by the readers and by the scholars, unfortunately, which is the Brahmanas, which is, they are treatises on ritual. But that means that they are sort of metaphysical texts trying to understand what happens in every gesture we do in terms of consciousness. And that is rather unique. You know, in a way, it's very curious because they are not, they are the contrary of popular, these texts. And lots of people simply avoid them. They think they're too difficult, too abstruse. And even some great scholars have tried to avoid that. That they made a big mistake, I think. In fact, these Brahmanas are the first great examples of prose in the world. There was nothing, even in Greece at that time, which expanded. You know, they are like Proust in a way. You know, the same sort of expansion in time and in time it takes to read and to understand them. And they should be, I think, available to everybody. The fact that here in India, I don't find them in a everybody still reads, for instance, the Shatapatha Brahmana. In a late Victorian translation by a great scholar, but it's more than 100 years old. There was nothing complete afterwards. You have to read it in a reprint of the sacred books of the East. But it is in a way as if in the West there were no editions of the Ethics of Spinoza or the Critique of Pure Judgment of Kant or the Phenomenology of Spirit of Hegel. They are essential texts. And without them, you don't understand even the Upanishads because the Upanishads are just the last section of the Brahmanas. To see what happens before makes you understand many more things than seeing them as separate.
So for those who are not familiar with these texts, I'll just take them on a slight explanation. Over 3,000, 4,000 years ago, there were hymns, the mantras. These mantras were compiled into poetry, which are called the suktas. The suktas were connected in chapters or really circles known as the mandalas. And together they are called the collection, the samhita. So when we use the word Ved, and Ved means knowledge. Knowledge is Ved, but these are hymns, songs, poetries. Nobody's sure whether they are codes to be seen metaphorically or to be seen literally. Then you see a shift in these ideas. A whole bunch of texts emerge, known as the Brahmanas, where these mantras, which are sounds, are attached to ritual, they are attached to gestures, they are attached to melody, they are attached to everyday life, and you see this journey from the samhitas towards what is called the Brahmanas. These are long, long, complex texts like the Gopatha Brahmana, the Path of the Cow, or the Shatapatha Brahmana, the 100 paths, and there's almost Proust. I think that's a nice way because as you go into these texts, which have not really been translated, there is one full translation available, as Roberto mentioned. They are long conversations on the nature of time, space, on ideas, and eventually moving towards consciousness. You can see this flirtation, trying to understand life, trying to understand the predator, the prey, the archer, the bird, the witness, consciousness. All these are being conversely, when many, 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 many conversations are happening. Kings are participating like Janaka, sages like Yajnavalkya, women and weavers like Gargi, Maitreyi, Katyayani. Lots of conversations are happening. And eventually, almost as if butter is being removed from milk, you finally start having slightly more coherent texts known as the Upanishads. And today we are very familiar with the Upanishads. But as Roberto said, between the Samhitas and the Upanishads is this vast body of texts. And it's Brahmanas which were in the sacrificial altars. There's the Aranyakas which took place in the forest. And Brihad Aranyaka Upanishad, the great forest of conversations. And this the forest of conversation, the city of words, you suddenly see, as you use the word, very powerful word, prosthesis. When we talk of development today, we say, do you have a house? Do you have a car? Do you have a mobile phone? It's everything is outside. It is material. Nobody talks of development of the mind. Do you understand relationships? Do you understand fear? Do you understand pain and suffering? Do you understand the purpose of existence? Do you understand meaning? Do you understand what it means to be alive? What is breath? What is prana? What are the sages? How do you construct reality? These are the conversations of the Vedas. They are not talking the... They move from the archer to the mind. They move from the birds to the mind. They move from the altar to the mind. It is an inward journey, not an outward journey, not towards prosthesis, not towards things, not towards matter, but towards the mind, going within and within and within. And therefore you come across the word yajna. And yajna can be visualized as a fire sacrifice. But it is much more than a fire sacrifice. It is as there is the yajaman sitting in front of the fire under the sky, under Orion, under Sirius, all the stars, the flat, firm ground. He sits on it, lights the fire. He pours and does the agnihotra. He makes the offering, the oblation of milk and ghee. It is a journey which apparently looks outside, but lots of things are happening inside.
Yeah, I totally agree. In fact, what is happening in these descriptions is simply what happens on the scene of thought. One should not be think, why should I take care of these very abstruse rituals with very minute details. No, everything which is described from the most simple one to the most complicated, the most simple one you find at the beginning, it's simply the act of touching water. Touching water because we all come from water. And touching water and giving shape to a wish. That is a vow. You start with that. And you end, after thousands of pages, with the Ashwamedha, which is the most complex of rituals. But in the middle, you have to remember one thing that I forgot to say before, but which is essential. The gods, the Vedic gods, are not, as we many usually think, gods who stay in the sky. No. These gods, at the beginning, were on earth. They were on earth, and they were trying desperately to get to the sky. And they failed. They failed many times. They failed many times. Why? Because they were trying to establish a connection between the visible and the invisible. And this is the most difficult point of thought. And at last they managed. But why did they manage? Because they managed to build a special altar, the altar of fire, which has the shape of an eagle. Well, mathematicians of today, this altar is a highly complicated form. It is made of bricks, and some at the center of it, there are some, but the bricks are calculated very exactly, in shape and number. And at the center of it, of this altar, you have some perforated bricks, so natural bricks with holes on them, which let the breath pass. And just to give an example of how strange these things are, mathematicians of today are still studying the formulas on which this altar of fire was made, because it is very akin to certain researchers in mathematics of today. And there are books on this subject. And you see how sophisticated, complicated, and refined was the thought behind this simple form. And another absolutely in a way disconcerting element. Once they had made an altar of this kind, they just abandoned it. They were not monuments, they were not temples, they were altars of semi-nomadic people who went from one place to another. And when they changed the place, they abandoned, and grass sort of was coming on top of these altars. So you see, and nothing remains except the idea and the calculation. Yeah, all right.
And it's a great, what you said, this whole idea, people always say the Vedas have great mathematics. And when they make the sentence, I'm always wary of what they are saying. Because when we talk of mathematics today and we talk of calculus today, we are talking, how do I make the best algorithm to make the next technology breakthrough? But mathematics in the Vedas, as you said, was not about making the technological breakthrough. It was about making the psychological breakthrough. It was about looking at mathematics. The bricks were being measured and placed. So the ritual of yajna was a psychological exercise expressed externally. So from form to formlessness, from the saguna, the form, to nirguna, which has no form, from thing to thought, from matter to mind. So you put the bricks in a particular way. They are measured correctly. They have perforations for breath, for thought, the fire, the smoke, the chanting, the melody, the meter, the vocabulary, the grammar, the Upavedas. Everything is done in an elaborate ceremony, right from touching of the water to the Agnihotra to the Ashwamedha, not to conquer the world, but to discover the mind.
To conquer the sky. Because if they were not precise in that, they would never get to the sky. And the bird could not fly.
The bird would not fly.
That is a point.
And the consciousness would not be discovered. Yeah. That bird who watches the bird eating the fruit.
Yeah.
And with that, we finish today's yajna. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the most fascinating storytellers, Devdutt Patnaik, Roberto Colasso.